Welcome you to this first conference of the Cognitive Science Institute for 2013-2014. In a few minutes, Jimena will properly introduce our speaker for today. But just first, I'd like to make a few announcements, some in French, some in English, depending on who's who is it for. So first, I'd like to invite you to the our next talk, which will be on November 15th, on a very similar subject. Michael Ogden from Georgetown University. The title of this conference will be "Do We Learn Language in the Same Brain Systems That Rats Use to Learn a Maze?" So that's on November 15th. Second announcement will be in French because it concerns mostly our students here. Il va y avoir deux, il y a deux bourses. Donc c'est un scoop que je fais. Donc la semaine prochaine, il va y avoir l'annonce des programmes, de bourses de l'Institut des sciences cognitives. C'est deux bourses de 2 000 $. Donc vous allez avoir jusqu'au mois de décembre pour appliquer. Donc vous êtes tous les bienvenus. C'est des bons dossiers. On a reçu une quinzaine de personnes qui candidatent. Donc vous êtes les bienvenus. And the third, after the announcement, will be for the 10th anniversary of the Cognitive Science Institute, which will be held on November 22nd, just a few days after Michael Ogden's talk. So it will be a semi-scientific and festive occasion to celebrate the 10th anniversary of the Cognitive Science Institute. There will be movies about cognitive science. There will be an overview of the 10 years in cognitive science. You're all welcome. And at the next talk, I'll also give you a more detailed program. So, Mena, if you will, please.
So, it is my very great pleasure to introduce this afternoon's speaker, Cindy Lam. Professor Lam is a leading scholar in the field of neurolinguistics, or as he defines it, neurocognitive linguistics. Known as the father of the theory of relational networks, previously named stratificational linguistics, he's the author of Pathways of the Brain, recently translated into Spanish, and of Language and Reality, published in 2004. Professor Lam was the founder of the Department of Linguistics at Rice University, where he has taught for 30 years and where he is now an emeritus professor in linguistics and cognitive science. His name is an entry in the Encyclopedia Britannica and along with a few American linguists. And in 2001, he was recognized as one of the three luminaries in the field of language to have graduated from Yale University. It's an honor for the Cognitive Science Institute that he has accepted our invitation. So please welcome Professor Cindy Lam.
Thank you very much, Jimena, and thanks for coming. It's a great pleasure to be here in Montreal, this beautiful city. And without further ado, I will start talking. You've seen this title there. So this is my argument. First point, language is the key to the mind. If cortical structures for language are like those for other high-level skills, then if we figure out language, we also have the answer to how other high-level intellectual processing works. I claim that language has been figured out. The linguistic structure is a network of relationships, a particular kind of network that I will describe. And therefore, we can now explain various non-linguistic psychological phenomena in terms of brain structure and brain function. Okay, first the claim, language has been figured out. Well, start with Louis Yamslev, Polygonometry of Theory of Language, and then, Lee Yamslev. He said, among other things, the postulation of objects as something different from the terms of relationships is a superfluous axiom and consequently a metaphysical hypothesis from which linguistic science will have to be freed. In 1966, I published my Outline of Stratification of Grammar, which demonstrated the truth of Yamslev's claim. Yamslev had made that claim, but he had never demonstrated it, so that we had to. So anyway, I had a supporting network notation system that, and I would talk a little bit about that. this makes it convincing that Yamsleff was really onto something. So here's how we arrive at the relational networks. We start out thinking about morphemes and their relationships to phonemes. Well, okay, we ask, are they symbols or the objects of some kind, as linguists have always assumed, until Yamsleff started saying, no, it's all relationships. So let's look at this. We have this element boy, so what is this? Well, we can plot its relations. On the one hand, we can say that it is both of, represents the meaning. It has some kind of grammatical function. It has some kind of phonological representation, B, O, and Y, in this sequence. Now, having done that, that symbol can disappear with no loss of information. It's a connection, not an object. Here's another way of looking at it. What do you need this for? The B just represents this, the O represents that. They're already there. So you don't need that. So we can still write it on the side just as a label on the map. It's not part of the structure. It's as on a highway map. You put Montreal next to the, or you put number 10 next to a road. That 10 is not to be found on the landscape at all. It's just for the map to make it easier for readers to know what you're talking about. Now let's look at these segments. What are they? Well, it turns out they are also just relations. On the one hand, they relate upward to other morphemes, to a B and so on. And then they go down to their phonological features. And so they are also not objects. Now, what about syntax? It's also purely relational. We have variable expression. That's the difference between syntax and ordinary lexemes. So this looks a lot like that boy. It's got a syntactic function. It's got a meaning. The meaning of this is to do something. You have it's just on the expression side here, but you've got variable expression. And then in syntax, these constructions link up to one another like this. You have a clause, subject, predicate. The subject is a nominal. It also has some Chomsky verb. It's also a nominal expression. We can add other stuff. In addition to the verb transitive, we have the be followed by a complement, which can be either a nominal or a location or an adjectival. So the syntactic construction is also a linguistic sign. Its expression is variable rather than fixed. That's how it differs from lexical signs. Therefore, the entire linguistic structure is a set of signs. The sign is a relational entity, which is a link between content and its expression. The expression is fixed for ordinary lexemes, but variable for syntactic constructions. In similar fashion, it can be shown that all of linguistic structure is relational. It's not relationships among linguistic objects. It's relations to other relations, all the way to the top at one end and to the bottom at the other end. In that case, the whole linguistic system is a network of interconnected nodes. Now, language operates. So the information has to be represented in such a way that it can be directly used for speaking and understanding. Competence has to be competence to perform. It doesn't make sense to think of a competence model separate from a performance model. The competence model has to be competence to perform. So the information has to be in operational form. The operation of the linguistic system takes the form of activation of lines and nodes. The nodes are defined on the basis of how they treat incoming activation. So for example, the ordered and, as we saw in boy or verb transitive followed by its object, first A, then B, indicated by the points at which they connect at the bottom of that triangle. So we have activation. It's defined, if activation is coming down from the top, it goes first to the left line, next to the right. And so we can define the nodes in terms of their activation, downward activation and upward activation. In this case, the AND is unordered, so you get both at the same time, as you can see here. With the AND, it means both incoming lines have to be activated in order to satisfy the node. Satisfied, it sends activation up down. And this says, In the OR, only one of them has to be activated. But this is not a mistake. Although this is an OR node, it goes down both lines because there's no way to know at this point which one is going to succeed. What will happen is that other things down farther down will eliminate one or the other of those pathways that have been activated. And so the upward one works the same way, just reverse direction. So those are the definitions of the nodes. They're operational definitions. And when the whole system is operating, then that's how it operates to make it possible for us to speak or to understand someone who's speaking to us. Now, the upward activation through the OR, as I said, it goes through both of those. Ordinarily, one or the other will be selected because of the context. So if you say, I will pay the bill tomorrow, then the context for only one will be activated, and that's the one that gets through. Or you can say, oh, I saw a duck and he had a large bill. Oh, well, that's the other kind of bill. Occasionally, you can get both of them activated, as in the pun. The duck goes into the pub and orders a drink and says, put it on my bill. You also get this phenomenon, the shadow meaning. China, Zhongguo is China, Zhongguo. But it also means, to any Chinese person, Central Kingdom. So you have activation going up to all these. These are called shadow meaning, Central Kingdom. Hong Kong is, Hong is fragrant, Kong is harbor, fragrant harbor. And it's called this that way because originally it was not fragrant at all. It was terrible smell. So it's relationships all the way. And at the bottom we have phonetics, but there are two kinds of phonetics. For the speaker, the relational structure goes down all the way to the points at which muscles of the speech-producing mechanism are activated. At that interface, we leave the purely relational system and send activation to a different kind of physical system, namely the muscles of the speech-producing mechanism. For the hearer, the bottom is the cochlea in the inner ear, which receives activation from the sound waves, and every fiber of the cochlea is connected to a nerve ending. From that point on, it's a different kind of structure. It's all relational. Now, at the upward direction, you have meanings. And in meaning, first we have to distinguish the world outside from what is inside the mind. And in the mind, we have both perceptual and conceptual properties. So if we're talking about the meaning of dog, we have perceptual properties and conceptual properties. The concept dog is defined by such properties as these. We know what it looks like. That's a visual subnetwork. We know what its bark sounds like, that's an auditory subnetwork. We know what its fur feels like, a somatosensory subnetwork. So all of these constitute perceptual information. They're subnetworks with many nodes each. There's also conceptual information, and all of this is interconnected, so that the concept dog is a network. This shows only the cardinal nodes of the network. Every one of these connects to a subnetwork of properties. So, for example, I'll show you that in a little more detail later. So we have perceptual structures in perceptual areas. We can distinguish between perception and conception on the basis that the perceptual structures are confined to a single perceptual modality. Conceptual structures are in an integrating area that integrates information from the different perceptual modalities. Okay, now we want to get a little bit of greater precision. We have to account for the behavior of those nodes, and in doing so, you quickly realize that they have to have some kind of internal structure to account for their behavior. So the original network's notation that I've been showing you so far is called the abstract notation, and we can also look at the internal structure and look at the narrow notation. So the narrow notation, every line of the abstract notation really represents two lines of narrow notation, one for each direction. And the nodes can be analyzed as pairs or more of one-way nodes. So something like this. In the abstract notation, you have, a construction E apple. This is the upward direction. You know, I'm not going to give you an exam on this, and you don't have to learn all the details. We actually have to have two directions And the abstract notation is bidirectional, but we, in analyzing it, we get there's one for the downward direction and one for the upward direction. So this shows the internal structure of those for the and for the or. The difference between and or here is shown as the difference between two different thresholds. This is the number of incoming lines that have to be activated in order to satisfy the node. That's the threshold. And then or, you only have to one or the other. Now, another thing you can do when you get to this level of showing greater refinement, show about competition. Competition works like this. There are two possibilities here. They're both two. That means they're and nodes. They have to have the other one activated in order to satisfy the threshold. If one of them does get satisfied, then it inhibits the other one. This is what happens, say, in English between P and K, or with any other language that's P and K. If you hear somebody say something like P, chip, and so chick, you not only get the activation of this K, you also inhibit the activation of the other one. It enhances the contrast. Things like this can be shown in narrow notation. So it goes like this. Okay. Now the thresholds. The or, only one has to be satisfied to satisfy the threshold. In the end, if there are four incoming lines, all four of them have to be satisfied to make it an and. But we can also have intermediate states. Like two, any two out of those three, or any three out of those four. So you can have intermediate degrees. The and/or distinction was a simplification anyway. It doesn't always work, especially in semantics, where you often have multiple properties of which you usually only have a few present, and it still is enough to satisfy the node. So we started out thinking that and/or was a basic distinction in language. Jakobson called it syntagmatic and paradigmatic. It's not a basic distinction after all. It's just a difference of threshold. And if we recognize thresholds, then we have the more basic structure. So and or are just special cases. What is basic is the threshold. The and, in order to satisfy activation, enters on all incoming connections, the or on any one of the incoming connections. Now, we also have the ordering in the and node. First the one, and then the other part. This is in the downward direction. You can have a wait element on the second line. You have to wait a little bit before producing the second one. If this is subject predicate, you have to wait until the subject gets completed before doing the predicate, for example. So activation continues on after that wait to B after A has been activated. On the upward side, where you're recognizing, then the wait element has to go on the other one. You have to keep this activation live so that that threshold will be activated until the second one comes in. So if you're listening, your subject predicate, subject comes in, this node is waiting for a possible predicate. So it keeps on sending that activation up there until the predicate comes in, at which point the threshold is satisfied. Now, of course, the wait element has to have its own internal structure, and this is one way to do it, to construct it. So the activation comes down here, it keeps looping around, that keeps itself alive. But you can't keep it alive forever, it has to be turned off sometime. And so at some point you turn it off. This is a blocking element, and then it sends on, then the activation can go on that one. So this gets activated after the first one has been taken care of. So we have two types of connection in the narrow notation, the excitatory and the inhibitory. We just saw an example of inhibitory connection. You can also get, well, in the case of competition, you saw this type of inhibitory connection. So two types of inhibitory, one to a node and one to a line, and you have excitatory connections. Now all of this I want to point out is based on linguistic evidence. We haven't considered anything about neural structures yet. Another example of how you, when you want to use this type of inhibitory element is when you have irregular verbs. For example, take normal past tenses suffix. But in the case of take, you don't use that. Instead, you use this. So this one takes precedence. And so when activation comes from here, it has to this one, you don't get take, and this one has to block this one, you don't get that suffix, instead you get took. So, another thing we have to look at in getting our greater refinement is the two directions. You know, we have to have two directions. This is basically because people are both able to speak and to understand, right? And so, this is, when you're producing something, this is speaking, and this is understanding. Since the lines are directional, in narrow notation, you have to show little arrows to show which direction they're going. Now the question is, how, if any way, are these connected to each other? So suppose they are two lexical items. Is the downward side not connected to the upward side somehow? Well, they must be connected. Now, the other question is, are they really next to each other like this? Maybe not. At this point, for the first time today, I'm going to bring in some evidence from neurology. We happen to know that the production side is in a different part of the cerebral cortex from the reception side. And so these down and up are phonological units. It does have to be, down and up have to be in separate parts, but they must be connected to each other. In the cortex, production ones are in the frontal lobe, these are in the temporal lobe. They have to be connected, and they are connected by fibers of the arcuate fasciculus. Okay, now we're going to look at neural networks. Relational networks were devised as a means of accounting for linguistic structure, and all these properties up to now, except for that last thing, was based solely on linguistic evidence. Back in the, way back in the 70s, when I would give lectures on this stuff, people would ask me, well, this looks a little bit like diagrams I've seen of neural structures. Is there anything, brain wiring diagrams? They would ask me, what's the relationship between this and brain? And I said, I don't have the slightest idea, because at that point I didn't know anything about the brain. But I decided I better learn something about the brain. And so one day I looked up in the campus directory and found the professor of neuroscience, and I called him up and said, could we have lunch? And he said, yes, sure. And so we got to have lunch, and we started, I asked him about neurons, how do they operate? And he started describing me and drawing pictures on paper napkins. And I said, wow, that's great, they work just the way these neurons would. So I'm going to talk about that now. Are relational networks related? Well, how can we find out? We can view the narrow network notation as a set of hypotheses about how, about brain structure and function. So we can look at every property of the narrow relational network notation and test it for neurological plausibility. So the lines have direction, they are all one way. Nerve fibers also carry activation in just one direction. They tend to come in pairs of opposite direction, as we've seen. Cortical connections, those are connections from one part of the cortex to another, those are also generally reciprocal. This is known from neuroanatomy. Connections are either excitatory or inhibitory. Axons are either excitatory or inhibitory. They come from different kinds of neurons, two different neurotransmitters. Nodes have different thresholds of activation. Neurons have different thresholds of activation. Inhibitory connections are of two kinds. Inhibitory connections in neurons are of two kinds. Type 2, this is called axo-axonal. It blocks the activation coming down an axon in neurons. And there are a lot of additional properties. I'm going to talk about some, but all of the properties are verified. Now, we can get to further levels of precision. So we have our abstract notation, we have our narrow notation. We can have further degrees of narrowing. So, for example, you need to recognize variation in connection strength. A connection becomes stronger with repeated successful use. And stronger connections carry greater activation. And this is how we account for learning. And we can account for the gradualness of learning, connections becoming gradually stronger with repeated use. You also get, along with that, variation in thresholds. So thresholds are not fixed as I have been depicting them up to now. They vary as a result of use and as a result of learning, and they're not integral. I've been talking about thresholds as 1, 2, 3. It doesn't work that way if you look more closely at how language actually works. What we really need is threshold functions such that a weak amount of incoming activation produces no response. A larger degree of activation results in weak or in weak outgoing activation, still stronger. So it's better to look at the picture here. So a weak amount of incoming activation, you get little response. In the middle range, this is, if this is input and this is output, outgoing activation. Increase in incoming activation leads to sharper to increase in outgoing activation. Then you reach a limit up at the above, where further increases in incoming activation will not give you much more increase in the outgoing activation. So that's this. Still higher degree of activation yields strong. So it's a sigmoid function. There it is. Okay. Connections get stronger with use. Every time a linguistic system is used, it actually changes a little bit. Every time you use a lexeme, especially this, you can notice this with unfamiliar lexemes, every time you use it, it becomes a little bit more familiar. You can indicate this roughly in the notation by the thickness of the connecting lines, or you can write little numbers next to the lines as approximations within the notation. So, what about the nodes? I've been talking about lines. The node corresponds not to a single neuron, but to a bundle of neurons. And if we turn to evidence from neuroscience again, we can find that the appropriate bundle is the cortical column. A cortical column consists of about 70 to 100 neurons stacked on top of one in each one another, comprising the whole thickness of the cortex. So all neurons within a column act together. When a column is activated, all its neurons are activated. So it's functioning as a unit. According to Vernon Mountcastle, who's the expert on this topic, he's been working on cortical columns for about the last 50 or 60 years. He published this monumental book in 1998, Harvard University Press. The effective unit of operation is not the single neuron and its axon, but bundles or groups of cells and their axons with similar functional properties and anatomical connections. So now we have more relational network properties for testing. These are four interesting properties about relational networks, and which makes them different from a lot of other networks you see proposed in cognitive science. Nodal specificity, nodal adjacency, and then the extension of 1 and 2 to larger units leading to cortical maps. So what do we mean by that? Nodal specificity. Every node has a specific function. I started out with there was a node for the phonological form of boy, for example. It's a very specific function. And it turns out to be appropriate to its location. All those phonological nodes are in one part of the system, for example. Adjacency. Adjacent nodes have adjacent functions. So P and K. If they are adjacent to each other, it'll be easier for them to have their competition by the lateral inhibition, mutually inhibiting each other. Well, we get direct evidence for this from the experiments reported in Mountcastle's book. So this is a case of experimenting that was done. I'm sorry to say that this experiment was done on a live cat. And it makes me sad what they do to these cats, because I'm a fan of cats. But on the one hand, I could say, you know, I wish they hadn't done this. But since they have, on the other hand, I'm going to use the information that they came up with. They used microelectrodes. This is the work of Hubel and Wiesel and other people, of which they got a Nobel Prize. Used microelectrodes so small that they could detect activation in a single neuron. And they sent these microelectrodes down from the top of the cortex. This is the cortex of the cat, the part of the cortex that recognizes when things are happening to the cat's body. And the neurons are stacked in columns, and so that as the microelectrode went down from one to the next, it gradually, it activated, it picked up activation one at a time. As long as stimulating this part of the cat's paw. Each of those, this represents the diagram of a particular neuron, of those neurons. And every one of them responds to stimulation of exactly the same point of the cat's paw. This is nodal specificity. The node, the column, in other words, represents that particular position on the cat's paw. It's very specific to just that position. That's what I mean by nodal specificity. Adjacency means that adjacent locations for adjacent functions. And in some cases, when they were sticking this microelectrode down, it would slip over into the next column. Very easy to do that, because one column is only 50 microns in diameter. It's very easy for it to slip over to the joint column. When it did, it picked up activation from the adjacent location of the cat's paw. So you have adjacent functions represented by adjacent locations in the cortical network. This is very important. Here's a similar finding from visual, for the visual system. In this case, you have a part of the visual cortex in which orientation of lines, line segments. So here, this represents the orientation, a line segment like this. And the microelectrode is encountering each neuron in the column, and each one responds to the line segment of the same orientation. But if you go through, send it sideways so that at each level you get a different column, then you have a different line orientation. And it's actually nice and organized, adjacent columns or adjacent line orientations. Here's another case of in a cat's cortex, the auditory areas, the cochlear position is related to the positions of columns in the cortex. So in every case, we have nodal specificity. Every node has a specific function and nodal adjacency. Adjacent functions, adjacent locations in the network. Now, consequences. This being the case, then clusters of nodes with similar function would really be clustered, because they'd be in roughly the same location, adjacent to one another. And this makes it very easy to account for competition, because the competing nodes are competing. Why? Because they're very similar in function. And so it's very easy to implement that competition, which requires that you have mutual inhibitory connections. It's very easy because they're adjacent to each other. So these properties of the linguistic structure are also directly verified in the neurological information, in the neurological evidence. Now, it also applies at very much larger levels. As if you have this general principle that clusters of nodes with similar functions, you can think about still larger levels and still more general functions. And so this is, we have an example of this in the visual area of a temporal lobe of a cock monkey. These are quite large columns of maybe hundreds of nodes each. And you notice, here's an example of adjacency of function. Here you have this. See, all three of these share that there's this kind of ovoid shape. Here's a kind of a, let's look at this one. This is circular and an elliptical, and on the other kind is elliptical of another kind. Here is this different shadings. So they all share something, and yet they also differ within this. And, not shown here, but if you further subdivide this, you get further differences. So here's a nice one. Here's another monkey face. And just different orientations of the face. And so on, you can see this. So you're getting both, this is at the very large level, we're talking about hundreds of adjacent mini columns, where you still have specificity of function and adjacency of function. Adjacent locations for adjacent functions. So this applies throughout at the large scale as well as the small scale. And it means that, in a sense, the cortex Not only do we have our little homunculus in the somatosensory cortex and the motor cortex, where throughout you have the body, all the different neighboring locations of the body represented by neighboring locations in the cortex. This is a kind of a map of the body, in other words, in there. What we're seeing is that this principle probably applies throughout the whole cortex, so that up in the conceptual areas, you're getting actual conceptual maps in the cortex. So we have these columns of different sizes, as illustrated in that last slide. We can call the largest one a hypercolumn, and we get a subcategory with what can be called a maxi column, and it gets further subdivided because of additional features, so you get additional specifications. So at the larger scale, when we talk about adjacency, you know, the adjacency of function or adjacency of location in the cortex, what this means is that in general, closely related cortical functions will tend to be in adjacent areas. So Broca's area ought to be close to the primary motor cortex. In fact, it should be close to the mouth area of the primary cortex, and that's exactly where it is. Wernicke's area should be close to the primary auditory area, and sure enough, there it is. The angular gyrus ought to be close to Wernicke's area, because this is where lexical and conceptual information is related to those phonological units, and sure enough, it is. Brodmann's area 37 also needs to be close to Wernicke's area, and sure enough, it is. Another part of the proximity principle is that a function that is intermediate between two other functions tends to be intermediate location. So Wernicke's area is intermediate between the primary auditory gyrus, primary auditory area, and the angular gyrus. Competition. I've already said adjacent columns will usually be in competition with one another. Why is that? Because we already see from the adjacency principle that they are going to be have similar functions. And since they have similar functions, they differ with respect to just one property or two properties while sharing other properties. So they're in competition. So we can predict that similar things are going to be in competition. And so in phonology, you have voiceless stops of the same position, of different position, envisioned line segments of similar but different orientation, similar but distinct colors. As a consequence of competition, columns of any size, the same thing will apply at larger levels, should have reciprocal inhibitory connections with neighboring columns. And this is a well-established fact from neuroanatomy. And so, and Mountcastle says, columnar specificity is maintained by pericolumnar inhibition. Inhibitory cells can also inhibit other inhibitory cells. Okay, we don't need to. So here's a model of the mini column. This is a very simplified model. The column actually gets me up to 110 neurons stacked on top of each other. This is a competition inhibitory node sends inhibitory activation to the neighboring columns. So the connections from a particular column, there are long distance connections going through the white matter. These are myelinated axons of pyramidal neurons. And then there are the horizontal connections, both excitatory and inhibitory. Another picture, lateral inhibition. These nodes are similar but different, like PTK, for example. Whenever any one of them gets activated, it inhibits its competitors. That enhances the contrast. We can show this in narrow notation in this way that I showed you earlier. A little bit about quantities of the columns. The diameter of a mini column is about 30 microns. Micron is a millionth of a meter, a thousandth of a millimeter. That means per mini column, per mini column you get 70 to 110, average 75 to 80. That means that since they are 30 microns, you under one square millimeter of cortical surface, you get average of about 1,460 columns, mini columns. We call them these mini columns because they are, you also have the larger ones, the bundles of columns. Per square centimeter, you get 100 times that much, 146,000 columns. Using those figures, you can calculate how many columns are present in, for example, Wernicke's area. You can calculate the size of Wernicke's area at approximately 20 square centimeters, multiplied by the number of columns per square centimeter, and you get close to 3 million cortical columns in Wernicke's area. Now, what you have to do is to be able to represent all of the syllables and larger and smaller phonological units that a person is likely to be able to learn in his lifetime. And it comes out just about right. This is more than most people ever use, but that's the way the brains work. We have much more capacity than most people ever use, much more. So it figures. There's another kind of supporting evidence. Now, let's look a little more. Here's the concept of dog as a network. I talked about it earlier. You have all these different properties that go together to make up the meaning of it. Each one of these is just a high-level local node with a particular function. This is a visual representation of a dog, but it doesn't do that all by itself. It's because it's connected to a large sub-network of properties. So, for example, if you zoom in on that one, you have this, and it's much larger network than shown here. Now, remember, because of nodal specificity, every one of these nodes has a specific local function. Every one of them is a particular visual feature which goes up to make up the whole visual recognition of dog. And there's much more than shown here. It takes, I came across one estimate that there are about 70 different layers of integration in visual perception. And so every one of them has a specific function. As you get higher, their functions cover more territory, as it were, until you get a very high level. Well, you have this. This also has a specific function. It's the visual representation of a typical dog. But it doesn't do that all by itself. Every node is a very simple operation. It has very simple operation in its own. It represents dog because it's supported by that whole network. It's like the executive of a corporation. He doesn't do everything that the corporation does. Those things are done by all the people that work at the corporation. So the guy's a CEO of a company that makes paper clips. He doesn't make any paper clips himself. He's just a, you know, so that's the way this is. So I'm not going to talk about pork instead of dog because we know a little bit more when we think about where these particular nodes are located in the case of pork, namely like this. And here's the same thing with, I've shown the subnet supporting the V here, part of it, and also for the phonological production, again, just part of it. At the top of the whole thing is the cardinal concept node. So let's put this into operation. This is a word network, let's say fork. And you see a fork, this is what's going to happen. What happens when you see fork? Well, okay. As soon as you get this one, see the concept node is connected to all these others, so it sends out parallel activation to all those. Phonological recognition would be a point in the Wernicke's area. You go across the arcuate fasciculus here to the articulation. See what's supposed to be happening.
Would you go with this hour?
Oh, I can use that. Okay.
If you could. Yeah. Probably see if there's a mouse.
Can you
try to do that? Okay.
ça marche avec.
S'il répond plus à 200 d'électrodes,
il répond flèche encore.
I can tell you what's happening. I just showed you that little scenario. That's what we would predict. And then we have some very nice evidence coming up in the next slide from an MEG experiment that was done a few years ago by people at the Max Planck Institute of Psycholinguistics in Nijmegen, Netherlands. The experiment was actually done in Helsinki. At that time, Helsinki had an MEG machine, and they didn't yet have one in Nijmegen. And they showed pictures of animals to the subjects. And the subjects were saying, we're going to show you a picture of an animal, and we want you to say what the animal is. And pay attention, say as fast as possible. And MEG, as you probably know, has the ability to show the time course of activation, because it picks up signals, magnetic signals from brain activity instantaneously. Unlike fMRI, which takes, you get the response in terms of increased cerebral blood flow only several seconds after the increase in cortical activity. With MEG, you get it immediately. This makes it possible to plot the time course of activation. And so we see that these diagrams, the time course of activation, after they see the picture of the animal, and starts over here, this is the occipital lobe. And that's where the input from the eyes comes, that's where the visual cortex is. So this was being activated, this was getting the most activation during the first 150 milliseconds. And then during the period from 150 to 275, this the greatest activation is shown here. This is the left hemisphere, this is the right hemisphere. And you see it, both hemispheres are activated. This is where you're getting mostly conceptual information. And then from 275 to 40 milliseconds, so this is really beautiful. Here is Wernicke's area. Once you get the concept, then you get the phonological image of the animal's name. Once you recognize it's a horse, here's the visual of a horse. Here's the concept horse. Here's what horse sounds like as a phonological unit. And over here, there's approximately Broca's area. You're getting ready to say the word. Of course, there are always multiple things going on in the cortex at the same time, so you also see other things being activated. But this is a really nice support for that little thing that I just showed you.
I try the last one.
And by the way, it takes, the person, after 600 milliseconds, the sound horse finally comes out of the person's mouth. It takes 600 milliseconds, 6 cents of a second. Neuron-to-neuron activity may be 5 milliseconds, but so you can see there's an awful lot of neural processing that's involved. Just getting and recognizing the picture and saying what it is you just saw. It seems instantaneous to us, but in fact, that's because most of our, the great preponderance of our mental processing is subconscious. I could go on. So anyway, so we find that all of these properties of relational networks that were arrived at by studying linguistic structure turn out to be verified from neuroscience. So this gives us a lot of confidence that with relational networks we're really onto something. So that brings us to the third part of my presentation, which is if it is the case that linguistic structure makes use of the same general cortical structures as other intelligent processes, then we should be able to say that what we've learned from studying language in relation to the brain can be applied to studying how the brain works in general, how other things work. And so I've taken a few psychological experiments, and which are I think rather interesting, and shown how we can account for them in terms of brain structure and function. The first one is a couple of studies that were done by Bard and his associates, John Bard, who was at NYU at the time. He's now at Yale University. And this was an experiment in which he took a bunch of students. You know, these psychological experiments always use students in psychology courses. So he took these students, they were brought up to the lab, and he said, now this is an experiment in which you're going to we are studying linguistic operations. And what they did was they gave them there's a scrambled sentence test, they call it, five words, and the student, the subject, has to make a sentence using four out of those five words. And
I'm not sure.
Oh, okay. Using four out of five words. Now, there were two sets of words, and they differed in this respect. There was one for the experimental group, the other for the control group. For the experimental group, one word in each set of five words, only one word in each set, was related to aging in some way. So there were words like retirement, or retired, Florida, shuffleboard, things that were related to aging. And in the control group, they were just neutral words. And then when the experiment was finished, the experimenter told the elevator down the hall. And sitting outside the office was a graduate student who was a collaborator of the experimenter, but he appeared to be just somebody waiting to talk to the professor. And he had a stopwatch, and he measured the amount of time it took the student to walk down to the elevator. It's a distance of 9.75 meters down the hall to the elevator. And the people who had been primed with these words related to aging walked more slowly. That was the result. Now,
I don't know where you are in your
position. No, we have to go, about two-thirds of the way. Oh, it's working?
Yes.
Okay, can we go?
I don't know where you are now.
Can we get onto the? I'm waiting on about 100 supplies. Oh, you can do this. Okay, get me down to past all that ignition. Right down here.
Yeah.
Forward.
Here's the thing.
Conscious.
Okay, yeah, let's go. Okay. Does this go? Okay, good, great. So here are examples of these five words, each set of five words, and you're supposed to, you can make a sentence out of this. Well, they will be lonely, at least not this one. But, and the elderly primary condition had these words. These are the words related to aging. So here are these words that were used in the experimental group, and there's one word of each that's related to aging, but not very strongly, just one. And this is, so the 9.75 meters, this is the people who had the experimental group, this is the control group. Very significant difference. They were so surprised at this, they said, we better try it again and replicate, see if we can replicate it. They did, and they got the same result. Now, I must say that there have been other experimenters who have read this literature, this paper when it came out, it made quite a sensation. Other people tried to replicate it and failed to get the same result. And so they criticized Bard. Well, we didn't get this result. And Bard said, well, you didn't do the didn't follow the procedure properly. So it's been controversial. But here's another experiment in which they took words associated with the concept rude. Another group words associated with the concept for life. And the third group had neutral words, just like these. So there were, here they are.
Now, neither the experimenter nor the confederate knew which priming condition was being used with these subjects. After finishing, the subject was told to go and see the experimenter in another room down the hall. Now, the experimenter was talking with another person, a confederate. The confederate was posing as a student who was having trouble understanding directions. So he kept asking directions of the experimenter. And the subject of the experiment was supposed to go down there, and he was supposed to, but he was waiting for them to finish. But they kept on talking until he finally got fed up and interrupted them. So the question is, how long did it take? They had a 10-minute limit. If they didn't interrupt after 10 minutes, then they'd say, okay. None of the subjects showed any suspicion of influence of the scrambled sentence test. So this is the results. And when they had the rude priming condition, 326 seconds, this is the time until they interrupted. Neutral condition, polite priming condition, 558 seconds, almost 10 minutes. And 21 out of 34 did not interrupt at all during the entire 10-minute period. They had been primed with politeness. This is how it shows up here. So a clear influence of language on behavior, and the influence is unconscious. How does it work? Okay, now in terms of brain structure, well, first we have the bidirectional connections. Connections in this, they're required for linguistic structure, and it's verified by neuroanatomy. And since you have this, you have reverberating activation, because when a note gets activated, it sends out activation. So it's, once you get activation going, it will tend to reverberate, and that increases the activation levels. Okay, there's that. We've already seen this. So bidirectional processing, yeah, okay, we've seen this. Okay. Now, consequences of repeated activation, the links become stronger, is a lasting effect. And as a short-term effect, the nodes become more highly activated. When more activated, they send out stronger activation. And so in the case of the words relating to old, you have this reverberating activation, which is strengthening the activation during the time. It doesn't take much, apparently, and it's unconscious. But all of these, especially old, are related to slow, which, by the way, was not one of the words used in the experiment at all. But it got activated, and it not only got activated, but it caused slowness in behavior. Now, to appreciate that, we have to understand the functional layout of the gray matter. We know, you know, visual is an occipital lobe, the motor is in the frontal lobe, and that the secondary areas and associated areas are adjacent to the primary, associated secondary areas adjacent to primary areas, and so on. Then the executive area and the prefrontal area. So in the primary motor and somatosensory area, here's where you have this, the map of the body, as it were. These are the elementary actions close to the sulcus here. And then adjacent to them, this is the map of the body. Notice how you have this adjacency of function. And adjacent to this elementary actions are higher level actions. Such as speaking. So you have a simple action, just like moving your finger, but picking up an object with your hand is a complex action because it requires all your fingers and moving the arm as well, and moving them in coordination. This is fairly, and so by the proximity principle and the adjacent, which comes from the adjacency function, you figure those more complex actions are a little more interior until you get the more and more complex actions, more and more inferior. And so actually, meanings of verbs pertaining to actions by any part of the body have to be in this part of the cortex.
as verbal concepts, just as nouns are in this part of the content. So verbal concepts, they include things like programs for performing activity, representatives, network structures, secondary. You get next network structures and posterior cortex. So you also are able to recognize when somebody else is doing something. Okay, activation spreads automatically among related concepts because they are interconnected. So this is the concepts associated with rudeness. As these concepts are all activity related, they are all presumably located in the frontal and prefrontal lobes. In the experiment, they were triggered by visual linguistic input, that is, the words pertaining to rudeness, or politeness, as the case may be. In this case, it's the rudeness words. And so this strengthened that part of the prefrontal lobe, which is associated with rude behavior. And so they were much more likely to interrupt. Percentage of students who interrupted. Another interesting example, in 1997, I'm almost through by the way, the first Mars rover landed on Mars. So as a result of that, sales of Mars rover toys increased dramatically, of course, no surprise. What may be a little surprising is that the sales of Mars candy bars. Mars candy bars, they're just called Mars bars because they're named for the person who founded the company, Franklin Mars. But that linguistic element, Mars, it activates Mars and Mars. And then the last experiment is a paper that is just now being published. He took 56 smokers. They watched a short television segment that included a commercial break showing a public service announcement. These are 56 people, all smokers. They were randomly placed in one of three groups according to the type of public service announcement they saw. The tobacco companies in the United States are required to show these so-called quit assist commercials, telling about the dangers of smoking, so that they will be encouraged to quit smoking. Okay. Then there are other similar anti-smoking things, but produced by a non-profit organization. And then the third, control. They said it didn't have anything to do with smoking at all. And then the subjects, after the TV viewing, they were given a break. They were left alone. They had the option of going out for a smoke. Now, so how many people went out for a smoke? Group one, Philip Morris quit assist group. Okay, the control group, 11%. From the anti-smoking PSA from the non-profit organization, 33%. They were watching a commercial that talked about the dangers of smoking. But it used words related to smoking. Those words were priming the activities in the prefrontal cortex which are associated with smoking. So they hit three. And the Philip Morris. Now, these guys knew what they were doing. This is a tobacco company producing an anti-smoking commercial. This is the graph of those results. That's it. Thank you.
So I don't know if there are questions on that.
Yeah. I have a question about the missing network, and it has to do with the redundant information. So, for example, a lot of nouns, and part of the network is representing noun. Is this shared by all the things that are going to end up being nouns? I mean, are there more than one representations of noun in the network?
Every noun, this is in mind with the specificity. This is really hard for people to get, because most networks that people are working with out there don't have this feature, and they think it's crazy to have one with the feature, that every noun has its specific node. But it, of course, is just one node of a network, because every one of those nodes is connected to all the properties of that noun. logic properties, graphic properties, and conceptual properties, and so on. But there is one central node, or cardinal node, for every noun. Now you might wonder, well, do we have enough nodes? And the answer is yes, we do. Remember, there are 146,000 columns under every square centimeter of the cortical surface.
Does that mean that for every word that's a noun, the information of nouniness is represented?
The information that it is a noun?
Yes.
No. No. They all have connections to their syntactic properties. But they share syntactic properties, so those are.
So it's shared information.
Yeah. Shared information. Those connections are converted.
So that's non-redundant.
Yes. Right.
Thank you for the presentation. I would like to know, could you give me another example with the weight structure?
The weight of
the first.
Are you talking about notes? Or
the first page, the first page in the presentation.
Yes.
You use the weight structure.
Well, the weight, W-E-I-G. I'm thinking W-E-I-G.
Sorry,
yes.
Could you give me another example?
Yeah, actually, the way that that little weight element that I showed there was a one way to do it. Now, the way it seems, this is before I knew about columns, the way it is actually done in columns is that the there are, in the part of a column, there are about 70 pyramidal neurons, and they have axon collaterals that extend up and down within the column to activate other neurons within the column. What that means is that once a column is activated, it's got a lot of reverberating activation going on within the column that keeps the activation alive for a variable period of time until it gets turned off by inhibitory neurons. And so since that activation can be kept alive, that is essentially a weight element in itself. That's what you need for the weight element, is to be able to keep activation alive for a short period of time. Yes?
It's just one of the models for presenting. Is there any one of them that's time locked with reality? I mean, is there, you talked about possibly 7 layers of integration in the visual cortex. Is there any way to.
Sorry,
You said in the visual cortex there were recently 70 layers of
integration. Yeah.
Yeah. And is there any connectionist model so far that managed to replicate the time it takes to actually? Is it time locked with reality, or do we still have a modificity?
Yeah, it does take time. If I understand what you're saying, it takes. In the neighborhood of 100 or more milliseconds to recognize an object after you see it, after it hits the retina. So that means there are, we can estimate about 5 or 6 milliseconds from neuron to neuron. And of course, that processing is not serial, it's parallel. So it's parallel and serial. So it's serial going from neuron to neuron, it's parallel going from multiple neurons every time that node gets activated. So, of course, it's extraordinarily difficult to recognize an object visually. And in fact, one way to appreciate this is to watch a baby about 4 or 5 months old learning how to recognize them. I watched my daughter, Christy, when she was about that age. She was lying on her back in the crib, and we got strung across the top of the crib with some objects. And she was. Actually, this was not just vision, she was hand and eye coordination is what she was doing. But she was very, she had the awkward movements in the hand. We think it's so automatic just to reach out and grab down. You have to learn to do all that. So you learn to recognize the object, and you learn to move your hand this way. And it takes a lot of practice over a period of weeks before you get that. And the same way with vision, it takes. I think that. I'm sure people have done experiments on this that I'm not aware of, but I think it takes on the order of 100 to 150 milliseconds.
model of this will be the same complexity, we managed to replicate that time frame, or?
So I didn't see the problem.
Okay, if we try to...
Oh, could we represent the... Yeah.
If we emulate the visual system with a connectionist model, and we try to replicate all its complexity, then can we manage to recognize
the... Well, you know, it might be possible, but its vision is so much more complicated than language. Than,
for language? Is it the...
That is, I must say, projects like that are down the road. That'd be great for somebody. I mean, you haven't got a dissertation topic yet. But then it might be too difficult. Maybe we're not ready yet for that. But yeah, theoretically, it should be possible.
How different is it for vision to recognize a word to recognizing an object in your model?
A word and an object?
How different would be the process?
It's locally what's happening at each step of the process is pretty uniform. Whether you're in recognizing a word as, say, you mean a spoken word?
No, visual word.
Oh, visual word. Okay.
So it's the same modality, but at one point you need to go to something conceptually linguistics from something that is already intrinsically linguistic, while seeing a chair, there is also a jump to something conceptually linguistic.
Right. Yeah. Those are. I shouldn't really say what you're saying is right. And you know, the language. As soon as you get into something you're recognizing as letters, which will happen very early on. When you get all that linguistic information coming in. But I don't really know enough. I would have to have studied vision like a lot of people have. I shouldn't try to pretend that I know what they've done. Yes.
Would you think that if you have a different language, you have the same concept but like in two different places, or where do you go?
In a different language?
Yeah.
And usually, there is a lot of variation between different people in how they learn their second language.
Okay.
It depends on the age at which they learn the second language, things like that. But usually, a person will have the same concept, and the two different lexical items in the two different languages. That we connected to the same concept. They'll tend to overlook the conceptual differences between the two languages.
Okay, and like, usually people say, like, I switch languages in my head. So would you say that when we see things or we try to speak, do we like really have a switch and only think in one language? Or it's possible that we think in many ways?
You can do it either way, and different people do it different ways. But you know, we think that you're learning a second language when you learn a second language. Usually what you're learning, at least in the first stages, and maybe forever, you're learning not the second language, but a second phonological system, and to some extent a separate grammar. But you're pretty much, unless you get really expert at the other language, you're not really learning a different conceptual system, and you're not learning very much different. The phonetic information is not going to be very different. So it's, if you're recognizing the language has different layers, phonetics, phonology, grammar, syntax, and semantics. But people, and so you would think that when you learn a second language, here's one language, and you learn a second language, here's another language. This is another language. That's not what it is. You tend not to learn a new phonetic system, and not very much new phonology, and not very much conceptual system. It's only those middle parts where you're learning something new. And so that's why you can say, did anyone here besides Igor ever hear Yoroma Jakobson speak? I guess he used to be, okay, good. You know, they say Roman Jakobson spoke six different languages, all of them in Russian.
I concur.
Yes.
I wonder if there's a parallel memory.
Yeah. Yeah, what I've been talking about is mostly in the area of procedural. Learning how to do stuff. That's what you need to be able to speak the language, is procedural.
Yes.
That's what your vision, learning how to recognize things, that would be all the procedural area. For the other, the declarative, that seems to involve the hippocampus, which I didn't get into at all today.
Has it been worked on specifically?
But anyway, that's also network structure, of course.
Yes.
And that would be great for somebody to work on that. I thought about it, but I'm not allowed to.
Can I ask a question? So I'm not sure I love the whole idea, but I was wondering if you're saying that we have no, let's say that phonemes and morphemes have a physical reality in the brain. Phonemes and morphemes have a physical reality in the brain.
Yes.
So can we say notes and
morphemes, actually not so much. I started out with morphemes. Morphemes are largely things that linguists work with, but people usually are, what they are learning is not morphemes but lexemes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so a word like happiness, morphologically you're going to analyze it as a happy and ness, but most people don't learn it that way, they learn it as a unit, happiness. And I must say, it wasn't until I was not only all the way grown up, but I already had my PhD in linguistics before it ever occurred to me that the word horizontal contains the word horizon. I was absolutely never, that never occurred to me. I was so old. So a linguist would say, oh yeah, horizon and tall, two morphemes.
Mm-hmm.
But people don't do that way. They learn those larger units, and even large, even whole phrases.
So if we have phonemes or, let's say, lexemes with the same physical reality, I would say that anything could be a node, so we don't need modularity. We don't need to have things that and semantics and phonology.
Yeah, it's, syntax, if you look at, we can say that phonology, if we're asking where is it located in the brain, but phonology is not in one place, because you have the listener's phonology and the temporal lobe and the speaker's phonology and the frontal lobe.
Mm-hmm.
And then, going along with the speaker's phonology, you have in the parietal lobe, you have the proprioceptive structures connected with speech. So you have three different areas just for phonology. Now, that's simple when you get to semantics. Semantics is all over the cortex. Even for a single word, you get stuff from all over. So, conceptually, a linguist likes to think of semantics maybe as one thing, but it's really, I would say it's really not one thing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's
the
question.
Any other questions, comments? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.